चैप्टर 11 ए ऑफ युद्धानंतर पर्व टॉक्स ऑन द धर्म ऑफ अ किंग. युधिष्ठिर आस्क्ड, इट हैज बीन सेड बाय द वाइज दैट किंगली ड्यूटीज कॉन्स्टिट्यूट द हाइएस्ट साइंस. प्लीज टेल मी अबाउट द ड्यूटीज ऑफ अ किंग. भीष्म वॉज इमेंसली प्लीज्ड विद द ह्यूमिलिटी एंड ईगरनेस ऑफ युधिष्ठिर. ही स्माइल्ड एट हिम एंड सेड, माई चाइल्ड, I am only too eager to tell you all that you want to know. A king's first duty is to worship the gods and the Brahmins. A king should essentially be a man of action. You might have heard from many that destiny rules a king. It is a fallacy in reasoning if you think so. Destiny does play a part, I grant that. But without action, a king can never help destiny to play her part. Destiny is powerful, but action is equally powerful. Both are potent, but to me, it seems that action is the more potent of the two. It is action which shapes the destiny. The next, or rather the next equally important duty of a king is truth. If you want to inspire confidence in the minds of your subjects, you should always be truthful. All accomplishments find a home in a king. His behavior should be above reproach. Self-restraint, humility, and righteousness are qualities which you have to look for in a king. If he has to be successful, he should have his passions under perfect control. Justice should be the second nature of a king. There are three more things which a king should cultivate. He should know how to conceal his own weakness carefully. By weakness is meant that weakness in his kingdom. He should take the trouble to find out the weaknesses in his enemies, and he should be very careful to be secretive about his plans. A king's conduct should be straightforward. Another danger for a king is mildness. He should not be too mild. He will then be disregarded. The subjects will not have enough respect for him and his words. Again, he should avoid the other extreme. He should not be too fierce, because then the subjects will be afraid of him, and that is not a happy state of affairs. A king should know the art of choosing servants. He should have compassion as a part of his mental makeup, but he should guard against too forgiving a nature. The lowest of men will take advantage of him and his nature if they are considered weak. Alertness is a great necessity for a king. He should study his foes and his friends too, incessantly. A king must consider that his first duty is to his subjects. He should guard them as a mother guards the child in her womb. Will any mother have thoughts of pleasing herself when her child is in her womb? All her thoughts will be bent only on the child and its welfare. Even so, a king should subordinate his desires and wishes to those of his subjects. Their welfare should be his only concern. A king should be careful not to place implicit confidence in anyone. His innermost thoughts must be concealed from even his nearest and dearest, and he should not tell anyone about his decisions. A king should be wise in dealing with six problems. The first is making peace with the foe who is stronger. The next consideration is making war on one who is equal to him in strength. Invading the country of one who is weaker in his next problem. He should use his discrimination when he makes a decision about these things. He should be prepared to seek protection in his fort if his position is weak. The most important work of king is to cause dissensions among the chief office bearers in his enemy's country. He should have clever spies at his service and find out the secrets of the enemies. He should bribe and cajole the officers of the enemy and win them over to his side. A king should be pleasant in speech. He should have about him men who are like him in nature and in noble qualities. The only difference between the king and his officers should be the white umbrella. The best king is one whose subjects live in freedom and happiness as they do in their father's house. Peace will be theirs and contentment. There will then be no wickedness, no pretense, no dishonesty, and no envy. The very core of a king's duty is the protection of his subjects and their happiness. It is not easy to secure the happiness of his people. He should use diverse methods. A king should be proficient in the art of choosing honest men to hold important offices. Skill, cleverness, and truth are all these necessary, or all three necessary in a king. Old and fallen buildings and living houses should be renovated by him if he has to win the good opinion of his subjects. He should know how to use his powers in inflicting corporal punishments and fines on miscreants. The king should remember that his treasury should always be full. Supervision of the work of all his officers should be done by the king himself. He should never trust the guardians of the city or fort implicitly. He must produce disloyalty among the people in a hostile country, and he must have friends and allies there. He should amass troops, and this should be done in secret. A king can never protect his kingdom by candor and by simplicity. A king should be both candid and crooked. He must employ crookedness and wrong acts when he wants to subdue the enemy. All these things should be concealed behind a candid and open exterior. Yudhishthira, how did the word Rajan come into use when a king is addressed? A king is like any other human being on the earth. His body and limbs are like those of anyone else. His understanding, his senses are similar to those of many others. He has the same joys and griefs, the same number of years to live on the earth, like anybody else. How then did it happen that he is considered different? This world is made up of men who are far superior to him in intelligence, bravery, and all accomplishments. And yet, this one man rules the others, though they are superior to him. Why should it be the rule that one man is worshipped by all the others? Bhishma, I will tell you. In the beginning, there was no king. There was no punishment. These two were not needed then. Men were all righteous and each man protected the other. As time passed on, however, the hearts of men began to be invaded by errors. Once error enters the heart, the mind gets clouded and the sense of right and wrong begins to wane. It was even so with the men of distant times. Covetousness was the first guest in their hearts. When covetousness came into life, men began to want things which did not belong to them. The next passion to be born was lust. Lust can never exist alone. It has to have a companion, and so wrath came into existence. As soon as these terrible passions found places in the hearts of men, righteousness had to beat a hasty retreat. Along with this confusion happened another great calamity. The Vedas disappeared. Righteousness was completely lost to the world. The gods were then overcome with fear. They went to Brahma Pitamaha and said, "Look on the world you have created, my lord. It is threatened with destruction. Please save it and save us." Brahma assured them that he would find a way. He then composed a treatise composed of 100,000 lessons. He treated of Dharma, Artha, Kama, and Moksha. He dealt with them in great detail. He formulated the rules for chastisement. The main feature of this treatise on chastisement dealt with punishment of two kinds, open and secret punishment. It treated of conservation of wealth by traders and merchants, growth of penance of the ascetics, destruction of thieves and wicked men. There was a branch dealing with all the religious observances, and another dealt with the extensive subject of legislation and the behavior that is expected of the counselors, of spies, of secret agents, envoys, and conciliation. All the many ways and means by which men may be prevented from deviating from the path of righteousness and dishonesty were described in it. After composing it, Brahma said, "For the good of the world and for the establishment and propagation of Dharma, Artha, and Kama, I have composed this. Assisted by chastisement, this will protect the world. Men are mostly led by chastisement, and so this treatise will be called Dhandaniti." It was studied and abridged by several of the gods, the first of them being Shankara. Finally, when it was to be given to the world, Shukra of great wisdom thought of the brevity of life of men on earth and made the work much shorter. It contained just 1,000 lessons. The gods then appeared before Vishnu and said, "Lord, indicate to us a man on the world who deserves to be superior to the rest. Narayana said, I will enter the body of one man and he, as well as all those who are born in his line, will be lords of the world. There was a king called Vena. From his right arm was born a man who was like a second Indra in his looks and godliness. He was born with a coat of mail and all the weapons. He was proficient in all the arts and the Vedas. The rishis made him the ruler of the world. Shukra was his priest. There was current among men the feelings that he was the eighth son of Vishnu himself. His name was Prithu. He made the surface of the earth level. Vishnu and the deities assembled to crown Prithu king. The earth took a form and came to him with tributes of gems and jewels. Prithu milked the earth in the form of a cow and made her yield seven kinds of crops for the food of all living creatures. He made all men regard dharma as the foremost of all things. Because he pleased all the people, he was called Rajan. Because he healed the wounds of afflicted people, he was called Kshatriya. And again, because the earth became celebrated for the prevalence of virtue during his reign, he was called Prithvi. Vishnu entered the body of that monarch. A pure man, when his punya becomes exhausted, descends from heaven to earth and is born as a king. Such a person is indeed great and is a portion of Vishnu on earth. He has a heritage of divine intelligence and he is superior to all the others. He is established by the gods and he is not to be slighted. This is the reason why the world cannot command him, but he can command the world. This is why the multitude has to obey his words of command, though he is like anybody else. Shri Krishna Arpanamastu.